Okay, good morning and welcome from the BOBST factory here in Firenze. My name's James Samuel. I'm the events portfolio director for the Labelexpo set of events we have around the world, and here also representing labels and labeling, bringing you today to this YUV seminar. We have a number of great presentations for you over the next hour, and also the opportunity for some questions to be submitted, which we will then get to ask to the panel after the presentations. So without further ado, I'm going to ask our esteemed panel of guests to come and introduce themselves to you, and then we'll head into our presentations. So over to introductions.
Nicholas Olson, Flint Group, working for the Narrow Web division.
I'm Robert Ray, Technology Development Manager at GEW.
I'm Peter Ludwig, Laboratory Manager at Schmid, Rhyner Coating, Switzerland.
And I am Samuel Topazzini, Project Manager for BOBST Firenze.
Fantastic. Welcome, gentlemen. So over the next hour, as I mentioned, we're going to be hearing a number of presentations which really answers the question, why UV, with regards in particular to food packaging. Before we start with Nicholas, I just want to cover very quickly an initiative that came up from a number of suppliers in the industry, again, around UV, and how can those with UV technology really get a place at the table to be able to get the business from food packaging converters and the brands to print their food packaging. There's a number of challenges historically that have happened that's disabling that opportunity. And so a group was born from a number of suppliers in the industry to come together as one voice, and a really kind of grown up and mature effort to say, actually, UV technology has enhanced so much over the last 5-10 years that now we need to get the message across of the advantageous opportunities it offers, not just the food packaging converter, but also the brand, and ultimately how their products can be picked off a supermarket shelf against their competitors. So back at Labelexpo Europe in September in Brussels, as I say, a number of the companies, many that you can see on this slide, came together for a meeting to discuss the challenges and, as an industry, what needs to be done to help kind of promote the UV technology processes. So working alongside the suppliers, we also managed to gain and garner support from the leading global associations around the world, FINAT in Europe, TLMI in the States, but also the RadTech associations, again, both based in Europe and in the US. So we're starting to get all different stakeholders within the industry and community to come together to really bring this message to the table. And I think the most exciting part is, as a basis of being a unified community working together, is that a number of the brands that came to the meeting and then subsequently through the press releases and labels and labeling magazine have really asked to be part of the group and want to be informed what is happening, what they need to know, how can they get involved in the debate. And you can see from this slide a large amount of big multinational global food companies and also some companies in the pharma sector as well as some other areas. So as a result, we now have a really good opportunity throughout the world to have the debate, to question how can UV technology be promoted and educated so that essentially the brand and the food packaging converter has greater choice as to how they want to print their food packaging and ultimately what drives the consumer to pick their package off the shelf. So over the next 2 years, through the Labelexpo Global Series and also through the Label and Labeling Magazine, we'll be doing a number of initiatives through the UV Safe Group to again educate, and also I think a huge PR campaign to actually change the reality and perception of UV being safe to print food packaging. So in addition to our events and publications, we're also looking to launch two events in 2018, one in Europe in the summer and one that will run alongside Labelexpo America in Chicago, specifically for that debate and topic and conversation for food safe packaging. More of that will be announced early in the new year, but I think at the moment it's probably the most exciting time for the food packaging market, in that now we have a really strong, unified group of suppliers, associations, converters, and brands all here to debate the message. And today is obviously a great opportunity to learn a little bit more from four fantastic global brands that are really helping to push the message and also part of the UV Food Safe group. So without further ado, I'm going to hand you to Nicholas from Flint, who's going to start with his presentation. So over to you, Nicholas.
Thank you, James. and the clicker, maybe. Well, good morning, everyone. Niklas Olsen here from Flint Group. Wanted to give you sort of a brief overview of what, say, UV Flex rings and what's the new with the food packaging compliant inks and how they differ from, say, maybe what you've used so far. Brief history about Flint Group. As you see, it's a group of different companies that joined together in, under the Flint Group. And I work, as I said, for the Narrow Web division. And as such, we've always been working with mainly UV inks from day one for traditionally label printing. So 30 plus years in experience with UV technology and also quite a strong presence in this market. My presentation is split into different categories, some of them overlapping with my colleague here later, so I'll be brief on those. But you'll hear a little bit about these five topics over the course of the presentation. To start it off, I think the role of packaging is obviously to sort of shelf appeal, brand recognition, and all that. And ink is a big part of that. And also, anything that you print on packaging obviously shouldn't endanger human life. So safety of the ink, safety of the packaging, but also that packaging helps to, provide better storage capabilities. The title, Why UV? And I think many of you are kind of looking at this saying, why should I even consider printing with UV? And here is, I think, one of the key trends that we see in the market, that where UV flexor presses or UV presses, narrow web presses, offers an advantage when you come to shorter runs. You could say and we see the trend that packaging is going this way, and therefore I think UV is a viable way to convert these type of packaging. When we come to packaging inks, any kind of ink that you use, solvent, water, or UV, or oil, you talk about migration. And there's mainly two parts of migration that comes into play. And that's, say, the ink or the chemical migrating through the substrate, or you have a set-off from reel to reel or from the back, say, on the back of the material when you print and reel or the sheet. So those two are, when we talk about migration risk, is that what we look at and what we test for. It has to be noticed that, say, when you print on packaging material, well, depending on the material you use, you could have either a barrier or no barrier. And typical with the functional barriers are aluminium, glass. And if you have these in the packaging construction, you don't need to worry about, say, the migration properties of the ink. Any other substrates, then yes, low migration or migration needs to be considered. Again, going back to say, how are inks being safe and how can we control what's in these? And there's different regulations that are being used across the range with the coatings or inks. I think my colleague here will also talk a little bit more about it. But these are the framework directive that we follow and that you have to follow that as legislating when you produce inks for food packaging. Recently, there has been some development also, which I think you all know about, which is, say, the Swiss Ordnance List. And this is a further enhanced list, I would say, where you basically have two categories. Either you have, say, substance that has been fully evaluated with all the different, say, aspect of how it will impact food or impact on human health. Or if you haven't tested it, then there is a limit saying that you can only allow 10 parts per billion to migrate into the packaging. Otherwise, yeah. So this is where the 10 ppb comes into play. Same have been applied from the Nestle guidance note. That is also sort of quite similar to the Swiss ordinance, I would say. But these regulations are talking about that you only allow a migration limit of 10 parts per billion for unevaluated substances, which then needs to be controlled in the process. Just to give you sort of a brief explanation of what 10 parts per billion is, and that's if you put, say, a teaspoon of something in a big Olympic pool. So it's quite small, I would say, almost to the detection limit, that say 10 parts per billion. That's why that comes up. As an ink supplier, obviously we have the responsibility of what we put in the ink, and we have, say, process with all the raw material selection is being governed, that we have to, say, follow these rules that are I mentioned before. But not only that, say, the ingredients as such, we also have to have a process that we say batch to batch, and no contaminants, no other ingredients will come into, say, a food grade ink. So that's a good manufacturing practice that we use, and it's a mandatory that you have in place to be able to supply for food packaging. Also, another governing list is obviously the Ink Maker Association list that say we put in as a further guidance for what we can use or not. To design a low migration ink using these rules gives you sort of fewer possibilities, fewer building blocks. And obviously the monomer selection is a little bit more critical. You still should have a low migration ink with the performance of normal ink. So that's, say, the challenge that we have as a formulator and a producer of these, that the window of possibilities with low migration is less possible, and therefore you need to be really creative in, say, how you formulate, to select your oligomers and monomers and photoinitiators. Here's a short description of how, ingredients are involved in an ink. I think you all have heard and know about, say, monomers and photoinitiators, and maybe worthwhile to take that, say, UV curing is actually a chemical process that takes place when the ink is exposed to UV light. The photoinitiators react and form a cross-linking that takes place between the binders and the photoinitiators in a fraction of seconds when the ink or coating is exposed to UV. So it's a chemical process that happens when the lamp is, say, or the UV light is exposed to these ingredients. Here's another chart that actually I'll just skip. So I think the definition of low migration ink, and as I said, the different rules are in play. We have these rules that we follow in all our products that we call low migration. These are our definitions that we use. We will support customers with the documents that you see here to the right. I think one point to stress out is the GMP and a good manufacturing practice. You can't stress that enough. And I think working with converters, how to comply with support that we will provide. So when we look at, say, these processes that are being used normally and how you handle products, we will provide all kind of, say, guidance on how to use our product and how best to, say, put it into best practice and make sure that the final product suits the end demand. That said, we have developed two sets of inks, one we call low migration, basically because of the different, say, end-use applications. And we looked at, say, the food simulant that you could test, and you have, say, different, say, parameters that you use to test these products. And with that test method, you get, say, certain specifications, and you could say for storage or end application. And if you comply with these tests, then you can use the product for, as you say, the end-use application that we have on the list here. Just one word with a new technology that has come in that we've developed in the last couple of years, and that's an LED UV curing ink. So not only do we have, say, products that cure with mercury UV, but also, say, with LED curing that are compliant with the most stringent demands that we have in the area of food packaging. I would say that this initiative here is a perfect initiative, how we could say help you as converter or end user to get into a compliant and a safety aspect of how to print. So we are happy to be part of this team and work as, in a collaboration, because in the end, we have to work together in order to say get everything maximized. With that, I think my time is up, and I'll hand over for Robert.
Thanks very much, Nicholas. So I'm Robert from GEW, and I'm going to talk today about UV solutions for food packaging. A brief background on GEW for those who don't know us. GEW are the number one UV supplier to the label printing industry worldwide. Over our 26 years, we've produced over 17,000 UV systems. We have over 140 employees across five sites in the UK, Germany, US, and India. And at our factory that you can see there in England, where we do all of our assembly, we produce about 6,000 print stations worth of UV every year. It's a family-run, 100% family-owned business, which leads to fast investment decisions, rapid innovation, and focused business strategies. And these are some of the sort of things that we hold in high esteem at GEW. So on to UV and food packaging. Today, the reality is that solvent drying is considered safer than UV drying. The reason for that is that a printer, in basic terms, has to ensure that the chemical, that the foodstuff, is not altered by transfer of chemicals from the ink. In the solvent process, which is probably the most commonly used, this is done by printing a batch of material, taking a small piece of that material and running a GC or other solvent test on it to gain a pass or fail result. The issue and the drawback with that technique is that you only ever know the solvent content of that one small area of your batch. So you only know that one part of your batch is actually compliant, and you rely on good manufacturing practice to ensure that the whole rest of the batch meets those requirements. And that batch testing is done offline. And so there's clearly room for improvement in the current process. The problem with the current UV process is that still solvent drying is considered safer. The reason is that the current UV process, what you do is you print your UV inks and you get your UV batch printed. You take a small sample of that, and you then have to run food contact simulation tests, and you then take that little sample and you run UV migration testing on it, which gives you a pass or fail result. The problem is that that testing can take weeks, 4, 5, even 8 weeks of time. So you only know a long time after you've printed that that batch is actually safe, certified safe. And so you have a process which is slower and considered less safe than solvent. Some of the complications around control, around drying with UV are that in order to know that you are getting the same level of UV to the substrate every time, a printer has to control a huge number of different variables. You have to know that the lamp is correct, that the lamp is clean and it's not damaged, the lamp hours are within a certain limit, the reflectors are clean and they're not damaged, that they haven't got coated with ink, that the electrical supply is well maintained, that the back pressure on the ducting for the air cooling is correct, that the lamp is free from contamination, and that the operator hasn't turned down or turned up the power incorrectly. And all of those things have to be controlled by the end customer in order to know the output of the UV on the substrate. And the result of that is that people, end users, get nervous about printing with UV on food packaging. In order to really guarantee the cure, what's needed is a 100% UV inspection. A customer has to be able to know the UV level incident on the substrate across the whole width of their sheet or web and all the way down that batch. Secondly, they have to have an accurate and well-controlled application of the ink, which is something manufacturers like BOBST within this group are able to speak about. And they have to ensure batch-to-batch consistency of the ink, which our colleagues from Flint, Schmid, Rhyner, and others are able to talk about. So if you have those three things, then you are able to know on a batch-by-batch basis that you meet the stringent regulations that Nicholas has just talked about within the EU and other regulatory frameworks. GEW's solution for the UV side of that process is what we're starting to call 100% UV inspection, and that's delivered by our multi-point UV monitoring system. Instead of worrying about all of these factors which affect UV curing and controlling all of those, we really just measure the final output that matters, and that is how much light comes out of the bottom of the UV lamp. So we have, in the picture you can see here, we have multiple sensors which sit along the top of the UV lamp casing, and they see UV direct from the lamp through a gap in the reflector, and they also see UV that comes through the reflector and scatters around the inside. So if the reflector becomes damaged or the lamp degrades in output over time, we see that as a reduction in the UV output measurement. And we are able to do that inline. So if you have inline measurement of your UV dose at multiple positions across your lamp, and you communicate that data to the end customer in real time, then what you have is 100% UV inspection of your batch. And that means you can remove extensive good manufacturing practice work required to maintain a UV system, and you can be sure that on a day-to-day, month-to-month, year-to-year, the level of UV hitting the substrate was the same as when you ran your low migration studies at the beginning of your qualification. There are two ways that we communicate this data to the customer. The first is just the most basic sense on our HMI control. So there are intuitive views showing the level of UV for every lamp, and there are customizable warnings, high and low level warnings. So if the UV drops too low, you flag a warning. If it gets too high, you flag a warning. And the customer can use I/O outputs, simple hardware interfaces, to decide what to do should the UV fall out of those ranges. Do you slow down the press? Do you turn off the press? Or do you just flag a red traffic light on top of the machine? That's the customer's decision to make. A more comprehensive method that we have available is something called Rhyno Process Control that happens via a software Rhyno API interface. And what this is essentially Ethernet communication live to a press, and BOBST have integrated something that they call UV track in order to take this data and display it on the press. Or we can output that directly to a customer's PLC, which we've implemented at numerous sites now around the world. And what that means is every parameter that is important for the UV system, the UV output, and how the UV system is running its UV status, is output to the customer live, and they can create a 100% cure map for their whole batch, which gives huge GMP improvements over existing UV processes, but importantly, we believe, over the solvent processes in use today in the market. A little bit more technical detail on the UV monitors. This is actually what they look like and how they're arranged down a lamp. Each monitor is calibrated and traceable to German national standards, so that's the PTB, which is similar to NIST in America. And every sensor has its own calibration certificate, so you can be sure on a year-by-year basis that sensor is reading the same as it was last year. When we're given the press speed, we're also able to give a dose indication, a UV dose indication for the UV sensor. And that sensor reads on a second time scale. So for a number of meters down the machine, you can have a full map. You can have up to 8 sensors across the width of a machine, subject to physical space constraints. And there are 2 spectral ranges available, either UV broadband, which measures the whole UV spectrum, or UVC, which just looks at the low energy spectrum. And finally, this system is purged with filtered compressed air, which keeps the sensors clean and functioning reliably in a demanding print environment. So all of this new technology means that a new possibility is emerging in UV printing, and that is better process control than traditional UV and solvent-based printing. And the way that would work, a customer would print a batch with UV inks, they would take a small piece of that batch, run their migration study testing on it, and determine the minimum level of UV they require to cure that material sufficiently. They set that level as the requirement for all future batches, and then via the UV monitors, they are able to gain a 100% inspection of every single batch, so you know that every batch meets the same requirements for curing as the batch that was tested initially. And that results in a UV cure map for every meter of every batch that is produced. And GEW believe, and in combination with the rest of the UV food safe group, that UV curing is developing into a safer more complete curing method for the food packaging industry. And I'm sure there'll be questions that we'll be happy to take at the end of the presentations. So I'll pass over to our colleagues at Schmidt Rhyner.
Over to you, Peter.
So I would like to talk to you today about UV low migration testing in particular. So the two components of UV varnish formulations which can give rise to concerns with regards to migration are monomers and photoinitiators. While monomers only migrate from insufficiently cured films because once sufficiently cured, they form into a polymer matrix, therefore being immobilized, as you see on the upper right corner of this presentation. On the other hand, photoinitiators, at least some of them, in conventional UV formulations, usually are small molecules which remain unbound in the polymer matrix formed and hence could migrate even with sufficient curing. So what we do for low migration applications, we use either the polymeric photoinitiator, which has a higher molecular weight and therefore has a lower chance to migrate, as you see on the second picture on the right, or we use a polymerizable, or also referred to as tethered photoinitiator, which acts like a monomer and is integrated into the polymer matrix and therefore does not migrate, like for example our epi photoinitiator that we developed in our company Schmid Rhyner. So how do we know if our packaging is compliant? As Nicholas already mentioned, there are a few regulations in place that we can use in order to be able to actually assess if our packaging is compliant. But there's no actual specific regulation within the EU yet that gives us any hints about inks and varnishes to use. So we rely mainly on the plastic regulations and use the Swiss ordinance, which has a list of components of different raw materials that are assessed to a certain degree or have this minimal 10 ppb migration limit, as Nicholas already mentioned. So when we have a look at the regulations for plastic food packaging, we get a set of simulants for each foodstuff that we might want to actually package with this packaging. What we have to take care of is that we always keep in mind that this is a regulation for plastic packaging. We often use paper and board as well in the printing industry for other food packaging, which don't work with liquid simulants. So the liquid simulant would actually penetrate the paper or board and actually extract the coating instead of measure the migration into the simulant. Something that I would really like to point out here as well is a lot of people want to do the 95% ethanol migration test as a worst case scenario. One should always consider that this is actually not relevant at all because it only is a simulant for actual ethyl alcohol being stored in the packaging and usually way overestimates the actual migration that happens. So instead of liquid simulants with cardboard and paper, we can use a dry simulant, which is the Tenox, which is the last on the list that you see on the bottom left corner. We also have to consider that some liquid simulants might even damage polymeric film by swelling it or penetrating it. We should never forget that there can be chemical reactions, for example, with acetic acid on aluminium. And we always should consider that in case that we can't find an adequate simulant for our foodstuff, we could actually do measurements on the foodstuff itself. The plastic regulation also gives us a set of storing conditions in order to simulate the long storage times that we have on the shelf. But this just to be mentioned. So how do I do a sample for an actual migration test? Well, what we need to consider is what happens after printing until I actually produce the final packaging. As Niklas already said, when we have a reel-to-reel setup and we wind up our printed product on a roll, we might have a direct touch of the printed surface with the food contact surface that can lead to set-off migration. These conditions have to be simulated before we actually hand in a sample to an analytical lab so they can measure it, or they do the simulation of these conditions themselves. It is important that these samples are, of course, wrapped properly in aluminium foil, so they can't get contaminated during transportation. In case of tests on actual foodstuff, we can actually basically go to the supermarket and take the product out of the shelf. Of course, we have to consider what are the maximum storage times, and we will need a blank sample, which is directly from production without any packaging in between. Then, as we always test only one cutout of a package, we also have to consider the way the package is printed. As you see in the cigarette package on the right side, you have at the top a spot varnishing. If we just take this part and measure that, we might way overestimate the overall migration to the package. If we take a lower part where we have no spot varnish, we will, of course, underestimate massively, because we have no varnish at all applied. Also, if you have a package that, for example, is not all printed cardboard, but you have also like a window of plastic like you see here on the right side, you will have to consider this as the actual surface to the volume that you have of your product package is not as big as you might expect at the start. Once at the actual analytical lab, what they will do, they will cut out this part that they need with a defined surface. And in case of a liquid simulant, you see here on the left, they will put it in a migration cell. This cell is closed, will then be filled with the liquid simulant and stored according to the conditions given in the plastics regulations. Then, if you have dry material, what you do, you take this Tenox. Here you see some ribbons that are bedded on Tenox, but usually we would take the food contact side and have it in contact with the Tenox over a certain time period, which is then the Tenox that absorbs the migrants is then extracted with solvents, which leads to the migration solutions. In the liquid case, of course, we get the migration solution directly out of the migration cell. The migration solution is then analyzed through chromatographic and spectrometric as well as spectroscopic methods. Here you see, for example, a GCMS. With databases that the analytical labs have and also with standard solutions, they can identify the different parts that might have migrated through the packaging, and they quantify them. In the end, you get an analysis. Fully here is an example from SQTS, who was kind enough to actually provide us with the pictures. And they also will give you like a feedback if you're compliant or not. So if we summarize that, what do we actually need to do? So we do have to have the right selection and preconditioning of the sample. So we have to ask ourselves, is the sample representative for the whole packaging? And is there the possibility for set of migration? We also have to take care of choosing the right simulants and test conditions. Does the simulant damage or diffuse through the packaging material, or does the simulant reflect the properties of the actual foodstuff? then in the end, the interpretation of the data has to be put into context with the real packaging conditions. So will there be an additional barrier? So do I have an aluminium foil which actually will reduce migration massively or not, for example? Then could one of the migrants have decomposed under the given testing conditions? And also, especially in case of, for example, baby foods, what is the actual ratio of volume versus surface in the final packaging? Because that might impact the actual quantities of migration. So I want just to give you a very short introduction into Schmid Rhyner. We are a Switzerland-based coating producer for water-based and UV coatings, as well as UV-based adhesives. We have a wide product range for solutions for embellishment for our customers. Our main product range is the Vesco and Galacryl, Vesco being our UV varnish range, which we have just a conventional UV as well as a Vesco LM for low migration, and Galacryl being our water-based varnishes. We offer them in different ways for solutions for different printing techniques and have a range of properties like, of course, matte and gloss varnishes. We have specialties. We also do customized varnishes for our customers. We have tinted varnishes and we have haptic varnishes for special effects that we call a touch and feel range. We also offer, since a bit more than a year now, the so-called polar inks, which are silver inks, which is which will help our customers to actually replace cold foil and hot foil stamping and laminating, which is cost reducing, of course. It's an inline process. We have no expensive tooling involved, and we have a very low waste rate. We also have the touch and feel, as I mentioned before, which is a haptic type of varnish, which we can use, for example, for embossed UV printing. We can do microstructure printing, sand touch and paper touch varnishes are also within the palette. We have a so-called 3D evolution, which adds 3D effect to your packaging, soft touch and wet touch varnishes. And the whole idea of that is that we want to help our customers to add sensation to their product in order to be more successful. Thank you for your attention, and I will hand over to Simone.
Scusa. You.
All'altra, così.
Okay, good morning, I'm Simone Topazzini, project manager of BOBST Firenze, in charge of the competence center of BOBST. So first of all, let's talk about BOBST. Who is BOBST? BOBST is the biggest manufacturer of printing and converting machine in the world, with 5,000 employees and a turnover of 1.5 billion Swiss francs. BOBST has more than 1,300 patents and invests every year the 7% of its turnover in R&D. BOBST is present worldwide, but all the companies are under one name, BOBST. Let's now focus on BOBST Firenze. BOBST Firenze has a wide range of products, starting from the MX, which is our basic machine for label, up to the M8. M8 is the new machine, 1 meter wide, which can print on every flexible packaging substrate. Let's focus now on UV for food packaging and the advantages of the use of the UV ink for the food application. As you probably know, UV ink is 100% solid compared to solvent, which is solid from the 30% to 50%. What does it mean? It means that the printing quality which we can achieve with the with the UV ink is higher compared to solvent, thanks to this behavior. If we take a look of the quality of the printing dot is higher, and this means that we are able to control the entire process. Controlling the entire process, we are able to use a camera system which allow us to adjust register and pressure fully automatically. Thanks to this behavior of the ink, we are able to do a job change in 1 minute, as you can see in the video. So we are able to totally change from job number one to job number two in less than 1 minute. Another advantage of the UV ink, time saving. Solvent ink dry. If you leave the ink on the ink tray, after 1 hour, it will dry. With UV, you don't have this kind of problem. This means that you can leave the ink in the ink tray for 24 hours and it will remain liquid as it was at the beginning. And you can imagine how much time you can save because you don't have to stop the machine and clean or overnight cleaning to start again the day after. Energy and cost saving. On the left, we can see a solvent dryer with this oven and this tunnel. On the right, the UV lamp. The dimension, I think that starting from the dimension, we can understand how cheaper is the UV process in terms of energy consumption. And now, thanks to the LED solution, the consumption is even lower. We can say that an LED lamp has a consumption which is less than 50% compared to the standard UV lamp. For what we have said, we can affirm that the process is easier to be controlled because the web path is short. On the left, the web path of a standard solvent press which uses solvent ink. The web path is long. On the right, the web path of a UV flexo machine. We have 1 meter length of material from one platform to the other. This means that it's easier to control the register and the tension. And thanks to this easiness, all the process is easy to be kept under control. Let's talk now about safety. Solvent ink can explode, not always, luckily, but can explode. We don't have this issue with the UV ink. This means that it's safer for the operator and for the machine as well, and you don't need to store the UV ink separately, as you have to do with the solvent ink. Now let's focus on Revo. Revo is the digital flexo revolution. Revo is a group of company. You can see all the company in the slide, which worked together to digitalize the flexo process. The reason why we are able to digitalize the flexo process is the behavior of the UV ink. Because as I told you before, the UV ink is 100% solid and can be kept under control. What are the advantages of Revo? The first advantage is that keeping the process under control, we are able to work not longer with the standard printing process, which is 4 spot process color plus spot color, but with a 7 color separation, which means that we print with cyan, magenta, yellow, black, plus orange, green, and reflex blue. With this color, we are able to achieve a Pantone flexibility. This means that we extended the color gamut and digitalizing the entire process, everything is under control. As we have already spoken and my colleague from GW and Flint underlined, UV is safe because UV is the only process in the world which can be guarantee. This means that we can certificate every meter printed thanks to the technology introduced by the UV lamp supplier. I'm talking about the UV track. So we can track all the UV emission and we can guarantee that every meter printed is perfectly cured. Quality and consistency. Again, thanks to the UV ink and its behavior, we have optimized the ink laydown. This means a better shelf visibility of the products on the shelf. 7 color separation, extended color gamut. The colors are vibrant, are realistic, and we can reproduce up to 90% of the spot color with the 7 color separation. Digital world of printing, what does it mean? It means that we moved all the process in prepress, so we have digitalized the process. This means that we start from prepress, then we print, and at the end we are able to compare what we have printed with the PDF, and we guarantee the entire process. This is for us the full digital circle. Flexibility. As we have already seen before, and it was also present in the video, we are able to change from one job to another in less than 1 minute. This means that we are able to print multiple jobs in one setup, and thanks to the unlimited Pantone that we can print with a 7-color separation, we are able to print unlimited graphics. This means different color in one shot, as you can see on the picture on the left. And in 60 minutes, we are able to print. This means that from the file in the USB key to the printing result, we need only 1 hour. Waste and time. Limited waste during job setup. As already underlined before, digitalizing the process and keeping the process under control through a camera system, we are no longer dependent from the intervention of the operator. The machine is fully automatic, so can change from one job to another in 1 minute. And there isn't no color matching in the press because, as I told you and as I explained, all the color match is made in prepress. Thanks for your attention. So right. Now I give you back the...
Here we are. Okay, thank you very much for all those presentations. You know, some great insight into the technology that's being delivered to essentially enhance the processes that UV technology offers. Got some questions that have come in. We're going to try and get through as many as possible. I'm going to open it up to the group here. My first question, and apologies if I get the name wrong, this is Ayida Galukatan from Back Ambalage. What are the control parameters and or the control automation options to ensure curing in order to prevent migration? And I'm going to lead to you, Robert, on this one.
Sure, okay. So I think in the presentation I gave earlier, I sort of really went into some detail about the UV monitor that's available from GEW to view the amount of UV hitting the substrate on every level. And when you talk about control automation and the way that a printer would be able to control that, essentially, if we're measuring the UV on a second-by-second basis, and the customer knows that I have to hit this level of UV in order for my process to meet the low migration requirements that I set during my setup and qualification procedure, you know, when I was first producing that package, then I can set a limit on my UV level. And if during printing the lamps age and that UV level comes down, as soon as it drops below the set level that you've set on the printer has set on the system, then the control will throw a fault. And the customer can then decide what to do with that fault. Either he decides to stop the press, you know, for absolutely critical processes, that might be the case. Another customer might just want a traffic light system on top of the machine that has a green, orange, you know, red indication, and the printer can then take a look and see what's wrong. You know, did something get into the UV system? Did the fan switch off? You know, whatever it is. So that's sort of the basic control that enables you to give. And the second level that I alluded to was the way that there is an Ethernet software connection to an end user's network, essentially. And the UV information for every sensor on every lamp is outputted on a second-by-second basis to that customer's network. And what that means is that the customer is able to provide, if you like, a certificate of conformity for every batch. So for that whole, you know, 5 kilometers of print run, he can say that across here and across here, I can give an actual physical reading of the UV dose or the UV level that hit that that web at that time. And that gives, you know, a level of a safety of conformity that just is not possible with the current UV lamps available today. All you have at the minute is a basic maintenance control to ensure that the lamp is giving the same output every time. And really, this then gives you, you know, a whole other level of control. And we believe that that control level is higher than what you're able to achieve with solvent-based processes. Because still with solvent-based processes, you only know that one piece that you cut out of your batch, that's the only bit that you are 100% sure meets the criteria. And the rest of that batch, you rely on good manufacturing processes to ensure that it meets the low migration criteria. And you know, machine manufacturers like BOBST have, Simeone talked about the UV track technology that's available with BOBST. You know, those sorts of machines and that sort of software enables a customer to track and manage this batch UV data. But that would be the control and automation, I think, that you're alluding to.
Fantastic. Well, yeah, I hope that helps answer your question. A question here from Patrick Poitvin at Mondelez International. By using UV inks, you exclude yourself from being used in food primary packs. You miss out on a big part of the industry. Are there any developments for food grade inks? And I'm probably going to look at you, Nicholas.
I'm not really sure I understand the question to that sense. Food grade inks, I read that obviously food compliant inks that we have are suitable for printing food packaging, and they are designed to print food packaging. But food grade inks, I read that as being printing direct contact or printing onto the food, which in my mind doesn't exist. There's not that many. And also, say food additives that you say colorants that you can use wouldn't be the greatest color strength in the world. But so I'm not really sure I understand the question. We could take that offline. But I would say food packaging you could print safely without any problem using the products that are designed for it.
I think on that note, with all the questions, whilst we only have a limited amount of time, the guests here will also be able to answer the questions offline, so we hope we can give you some more detail. Some really interesting case studies there in terms of, we looked at, you know, the speed to market, the dosage measurement in place. So the technical side, it really seems that, you know, there is a real advantageous opportunity to use UV technology. But a great question here from Mida Fanson of Scene Print. And this comes back to supermarket shelf appeal. How do you remove the smell of ink and glue in the food packaging? Because as a consumer, I don't want to pick up a food package that has a smell that's perceived or comes from the UV process. So maybe Nicholas, you want to go on that one first, and we'll go to the panel.
I think the challenge, to remove odor or smell from a package, it's obviously you have to set the right property or the right product beforehand. It's very difficult if you have some sort of contaminant or something that smells. Yeah, that's difficult to remove. So I think the criteria should be, select coatings, varnishes, or inks that are designed with low odor. I think there is a ways of looking at, say, purer, and most of the products that I would say are suitable for food packaging are with sort of passing all the odor tests that we know of, at least the Robinson's test and like that. I know odor is subjective. Some people you get used to. So that's also where I think odor panels are quite useful. I don't think you could say remove odor. You have to choose the right product beforehand with the criteria that you should have.
Okay, I think we've got time just for one more question. This has come from Boan Elevisky at Alcavoid. How safe is UV varnish for using in the pharma industry, both label and secondary packaging? I'm going to ask anyone would like to answer this. And I'm, Peter, kind of looking at you for this one.
Are you? Well, I think this depends a lot on where you're moving, like in terms of country and regulations on this topic. It is on secondary packaging. I don't see any issues as long as you go for low migration, and I think Nicholas would probably also agree with that. There are, of course, also implementations that go basically on the primary package, and there you have an issue as soon as you print, but this is more maybe towards inks when you have a writing on the aluminium side. That when you break open and take out a pill, that you might have a possible contact. So I don't know how you would deal with such a kind of ink in that case.
I mean, if it's say for printing on the backside of pharmaceutical, obviously that's an aluminium, so you don't have to worry about say migration in that sense. Because, but when you break out, yeah, you could say how long eventually is the pill in contact with the ink. I would call it that from a safety point of view. If you have say a low migration ink or low migration varnish, that say we formulate for the end use application as we indicate, and how we test the ingredients we have, they should be safe and considered safe for any kind of application. I would call pharmaceutical being similar to any kind of food application, and the same ingredients applies.
I mean, mainly there's just always a question as well for the common regulations by the countries applied, which might be over-regulating as well.
Okay, well, thank you. I think we've literally just about run out of time there. But as I mentioned earlier on, all the other questions have been submitted. We will share amongst the panel here and get you some direct answers via the channel back to you. Massive thank you for everyone that came and logged in to listen to this webinar. As mentioned, this is a really an ongoing process through the UV Safe Group. And as I was saying, in the new year, we hope to kind of give you some more information about other events and activities via the UV Food Safe Group into the next year. So that just leaves me to say a massive thank you to the panel here. Thank you to yourselves. And now I think it's the 15th of December, so a very apt time to actually, for the first time for me, to say Merry Christmas and have a Happy New Year to everyone. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
Took 10 years to realize why the engine